Okay, so the idea of this tutorial came when we thought about having a special session at this CP conference about social choice and preferences and optimization. And the idea came about because we think that social choice and CP have much in common and they can contribute to each other in a very significant way. Collective decision making, which is what social choice is about, is an increasing topic for research and for applications because there are more and more systems where people and even artificial agents connect, share information, make decisions together. And CP can play a big role there, can make significant contribution. Of course, to do that, we also have to link with other communities, like, such as preference modeling, reasoning, and aggregation, so knowledge, representation, and reasoning, with voting theory and game theory, multi-agent systems, machine learning, reasoning under uncertainty, and others. So in this particular tutorial, I will talk about collective decision-making and mostly voting theory. So there are many people here that already know a lot about voting theory, game theory, and social choice, so I will not give much information to them, but I hope that gives others some useful information and some interesting topics that, you know, CP people may want to work on. So it's all about decision making. So as I see it, if when you are alone, a single agent, decision making is just based on our constraints and preferences over the possible decisions that we can make. And constraint reasoning is enough in many cases. And the constraint reasoning, I see it as kind of a Boolean algebra. I was preparing these slides for the when I went to Cork last year for the Bool celebrations. And I think this is very suitable for describing decision making for a single agent. So decisions are either acceptable or not. So we talk about true or false here. And then there may be complex decisions that have to do with several things that each one of them could be acceptable or not, and then you need to combine them together, and the overall complex decision is acceptable if all of its parts are acceptable, so you use an AND operator. And then you compare decisions by using the OR operator, because you say a complex decision is better, more preferable than another one, if its truth value is better than another one, which means it's true with respect to false, or so on. So you use the OR operator. For example, when you need to choose a car and you have two features that are important to you, the color and the maker, and you have some possible alternatives for the color, blue, gray, and white, you have three possible alternatives for the maker, and then you say, I accept only some colors, I accept only some makers, and so when you put together the two, you understand with the AND operator whether a possible car is acceptable or not. So for example, the blue Toyota is acceptable because blue is acceptable and Toyota is acceptable, but the gray BMW is not because gray is acceptable. Gray is acceptable, but BMW is not. Okay? So the AND operator will not give you, tell you that that complex decision is acceptable. And of course, when you want to work, you know, this is a simple case where you have this acceptable or non-acceptable parts or decisions, but usually you don't have just constraints, but you have preferences, so you prefer some colors to others among the acceptable ones, and you prefer some makers to others among the acceptable ones. And then you combine these acceptability levels, assuming that you use a quantitative formalism to describe your preferences. So for example, here you say, I prefer blue to gray, and I use a scale between 0 and 1. So I tell that I prefer blue at 0.7 out of my scale, and gray 0.5 out of my scale, so assuming that 1 is the top preferred element, and 0 is the least one. And then I prefer Toyota to Mercedes, 0.9 Toyota, 0.5 Mercedes, and so on. And then I combine the different parts and acceptability levels of the different parts by using some other operator, which now cannot be just the logical AND, but it has to be something else that deals with these numbers, 0.9, 0.7, and so on. So for example, what we call fuzzy constraints, just use conjunctive fuzzy constraints, that uses as the combination operator the minimum. So you, out of all these numbers, you take the minimum. And in some applications, maybe not when you buy a car, but in some applications, this is good enough to remember just the minimum of these numbers, and especially in those applications where you want to make sure that the worst scenario does not happen. You know, so you remember what is worst, you know, the least number, and then you compare possible decision according to this number. So this is one way of modeling preferences, and ways of modeling preferences are going to be important in social choice, because social choice has to do with collecting preferences of various agents to make a collective decision. So if we go a little bit more into ways of modeling preferences, this is one which we may call soft constraints, and we may call it a quantitative way of modeling preferences, because you use this elements, which are not necessarily numbers like the ones that I gave you here, but are elements out of a scale, which is a partially or totally ordered set of these elements, and then you use this structure, this ordered structure, to compare whether you like, whether you prefer something more than something else. So it's a quantitative in that sense. But there are also other ways of modeling preferences, like the more qualitative ones, where you don't use these additional elements to say whether something is more preferred than something else, but you just express your preferences in a qualitative way. And the one example that I usually give is CPNets. So CPNets are a completely different way of modeling preferences with respect to soft constraints. So here is a very typical, you know, tutorial example for CPNets about the menu that we are going to choose for eating. And so we have three possible elements or ingredients of our decisions. So it's a complex decision because it's made out of three parts: the main course, the wine, and the fruit. And for each one, I suppose we have two possible alternatives, and then in a CPNet, you give your preferences over each variable, okay? Not over sets of variables, but over each variable. And some of the variables are called independent, meaning that your preferences over the values of that variable, which are just a total order, are given independently of any other variable. So, for example, the main course is an independent variable. I prefer fish to meat. I don't care about the wine, I don't care about the fruit, I prefer fish to meat. But for the fruit, the same is an independent variable. I prefer peaches to strawberries. These are the two options, and I tell you my preferences in terms of a total order. Instead, wine is a dependent variable. It depends on the variable main course, meaning that I give you a total order over the values of wine for each value of this other variable over here. And there is this graphical notation with this arrow. So for example, if there is fish, if this variable has value fish, then I prefer white to red. Otherwise, I prefer the opposite, okay? So, and this, in the left side of this slide, this is a CPNet, and this is the dependency graph of the variables, which are called features, but variables of the CPNet. And in this case, does not have cycles. And it's somewhat reasonable to think that you should not have cycles in your dependency graph, because if you have cycles, either directly or, you know, or long cycles, it means that to tell me your preferences over wine, you need to see what you're going to eat, for example. And to tell me what you're going to, how your preferences over what you're going to eat, you need to understand what you're going to have as wine. So you understand that it's not that rational to have these cycles in a CPNet, differently from, you know, constraints, where having cycles in the constraint graph is perfectly okay from the rational point of view. But anyway, this is an acyclic dependency graph. And while in constraints and soft constraints, you pass from you give an ordering over the various solutions, over the various possible complex decisions, by just looking at these numbers, you know, the scale from 0 to 1 in fuzzy constraints. If a complex decision has a value which is higher than another one, then this is more preferred than the other one. Well, here you don't have these additional elements, so you have to find a way to go from this CPNet to the ordering over the possible decision, which are the menus here. And in CPNets, you just derive an ordering, usually a partial ordering, if the dependency graph does not have cycles, is always a partial order, no cycles, among the possible solutions or decisions. So for example, here I wrote all the possible menus, like fish, wine peaches, fish, red peaches, and so on. And this is the partial order that comes out of that. And in this partial order, there is the optimal, meaning the most preferred solution, which is this menu. And why is this optimal? Because if you look at the preferences that we specified, this is the best that you can do. Because for the main course, fish is better than meat, and here we have fish. For the fruit, peaches is better than strawberries, and here we have peaches. And for the wine, given that we have fish, white is better than red, and here we have white. Okay, so this is the best that you can do according to the preferences, and this, by the way, is the worst that you can do. So, and then in the middle you have this partial order, with because some things are dominate others, like these two. Why this one dominates this one? Because this is differ only for the main course, which is fish here and meat here, and we said that fish is better than meat, so this is better, more preferred than that. But others are also incomparable, also here and here. Yeah?
What's going to the screen?
Sorry. Yeah. Anyway, you understand? Okay. Okay, so this is a different way of modeling preferences. And now that we have an idea of how to model preferences for a single agent, now let's start thinking about multiple agents. So why do we need group or collective decision making? As I said at the beginning, because there are more and more scenarios where people and artificial agents collaborate together and help each other, communicate, argument over some topic, and then influence each other, possibly even manipulate each other, and then get to a collective decision. Formally, this group decision making is defined in a very simplest form as given an input, a set of possible decisions, and then you have a collection of agents that express their own preferences, for example, in one of the ways that we have described, over the possible decisions, and then the output is one of these decisions, based on the preferences of all the agents. This is the simplest form, because the output could also be something more complicated, because, for example, the output would be a ranking of all the possible decisions based on the preferences of the other. But for this tutorial, let's assume that the output is one decision that is chosen out of the possible ones. For example, when a family or a set of people needs to buy a car, each family member has his own preferences, and then the preferences will be aggregated in some way to choose one car. When a hiring committee has to decide who to hire out of a set of candidates, each one of the people in the committee have their own preferences over the possible candidates, and then you need to put together in some way these preferences in order to choose who to hire. There are many ways to do this aggregation, and usually what we call voting rules are used, I will tell you a little bit about some very basic voting rules to give you an idea, and some of the issues that come up when talking about these voting rules, and having to choose among so many voting rules, and how you choose among them. So the voting rules are just functions that go from a profile, which is just a terminology intended to describe this collection of preferences over the possible decisions given by all the agents that are involved in this collective decision making, and this is the input of the function, and the output is one of the candidate decisions. And here I just wrote some names that came to my mind on the spot about some names of voting rules, just to make you understand that there are very many voting rules. And each one of them may give you a different result at the end. So there must be a way to understand how to discriminate among these different voting rules, and the way that the social choice community has come up with is to study the properties of these voting rules, like fairness, unanimity, monotonicity, and we will see some of them. And then to understand if in every scenario where you have to make a collective decision, to understand which are the properties that you would like to have in that scenario for the voting rule that you're going to use there, and then use only voting rules that have those properties. Things are not that simple, because as soon as you say that you desire some properties, you may end up in situations where there are actually no voting rules that satisfy those properties, but you know, there are, you can discriminate a little bit. So from a very simple point of view, this is the very simplest scenario. So you have the preference ordering of each of agents, you give this is the profile, you give this as input to the voting rule, and then the voting rule comes out with a collective decision, which can be, as we said for this tutorial, is just one of the candidate decisions, or it could be a ranking of all the candidate decisions, or some structure that represents the ranking of the candidate decision. So let's look at some very simple voting rules. So here I just list four of them, and I give some example about these four. So one is plurality, the simplest one. Plurality says that from each agent, the plurality rule just wants the top choice for that agent. Okay? Each agent has in his mind his own ranking of all the possible decisions, but it only has to submit the top choice. Okay? Because only this information is going to be used by the voting rule, because the voting rule just takes all these top choices and then counts how many times each candidate decision appears in this collection of top choices. And the one that appears the most, this is the decision that is given as a result. Okay? Borda is in some sense the other extreme, because the Borda voting rules needs the complete ranking, assume it's a total order, of all the candidate decisions from each agent, okay? Because Borda is going to assign a score to all candidate decisions depending on the position in this ranking given by each agent. So a score 0 if it is the worst choice, score 1, 2, 3, up to score n minus 1 if it is the top choice for that agent. And then once you assign these scores, you just sum up for each candidate decision all the scores that it gets out of all the agents, and the one that has the highest score is going to be the decision that is going to be taken. Approval is again a different voting rule, so they're all very simple, but they're giving you a different flavor of what voting rule wants from the agents, because approval does not want a ranking, does not want a part of the ranking. Approval just wants a set of acceptable decisions for that agent, right? Not a ranking, a set. And then is going to count how many times a candidate decision appears in these sets that come from the agents, and then the one decision that appears in most approval sets is going to be the chosen decision. Approval has many variants. One of them is called K-approval, because instead of asking for a set of approved decision from each agent, you ask for a set which has cardinality K. So you are forcing each agent to tell you exactly K decisions that are going to be acceptable for him. And then you do the same thing as approval. So let's look at some examples. So plurality, the example here, I have six voters, these six people here, and then I have three candidates, these three. And then, again, for plurality, I only need the top choice. And so I don't know what they think about the ranking of these three candidates, but I know that for this agent, the top choice is this one, for this agent, the top choice is this one, and so on. So then plurality just looks at each candidate, and since this appears three times, this appears two times, and this only one, she's going to be the winner. Okay, that's plurality. So you see that very little information is required from the agents. And the rule is very simple, it's easy to compute the winning decision, and very little information to be elicited from the agents. So let's look at Borda. Borda, we said, is the other extreme. I need from each voter, from each agent, I need the whole ranking. So top choice, second choice, third choice, fourth choice. Here I put four candidates instead of three. And then I'm going to give scores according to the positions. So here I give score 0, 1, 2, 3 according to the position in the ranking to each, for each agent. So then for each one of these, so let's take this misspeak. So she gets a score of 2, plus 1, plus 2, plus 0, plus 2. Okay, that's the overall score that she gets. I count the same for all everybody else, and then the one that has the maximum score is going to win. So in this case, this is going to be the winner because it has a score of 9. Fine? This is important. Okay, so let's go to approval. Another different way. So for approval, I don't care. I mean, now actually, I wrote this one on top of the other one, but actually this is a set. The set of the approved decisions for that voter, for that agent. So I, for example, I, in this example, I said that for this voter, these three are the candidate decisions that are acceptable for him. This voter, only this one is acceptable, this one has these two, and so on. And you notice that I just took the top portion of their ranking that they have in their mind, because it doesn't make sense that if they have a certain ranking, they approve something at the top and something at the bottom and not in between. So, but even if I wrote it like this, one on top of the other, it is actually a set that is provided to the board, to the approval, voting roll. So, and then I count how many times, so for example, Miss Piki appears in 1, 2, 3, and 4 approval sets. So she gets a score of 4. And then I do the same with Borda, with scores, the one that has the highest score is going to win. So again, here, this is going to be the winner. So you see that even in this example where I use the same ranking for approval and for Borda, you already notice that the winner is different. Borda was giving a winner, which I think was this one, and approval is given another one. The variant of approval, which is with K, cardinality of the approved set, for example, do approval says, don't give me a set of cardinality 2, candidate decisions that are approved for you. So I just took the top two, the two elements which are at the top for each ranking of each one, and then I do the same calculation as before, and in this case, two approval, different rule, same preferences from the agents, a different result. This is going to be, this is going to be the winner. Okay? Okay, so there are many, many other voting rules. And so you already, from these four, you wonder, okay, but then who, what am I going to choose? Since one, each one of them is going to give me a different result. So which one is the voting rule that I should choose? And so, as I said, social choice researchers decided that the best approach was to study the properties, interesting, desirable properties of the rule. For example, is the rule monotonic? It's one of the properties, and I will tell you later what it means. And the bottom line of all this research is that when you have just two candidates, two candidate decisions, then you don't need to worry about which voting rule you're going to choose, because all the voting rules basically are going to collapse to one, which is majority, which is plurality, which plurality means majority when you have just two things. So the problem is when you have more than two candidates, and then you have to understand what to do. So let's look at some of the properties. For example, one of the properties that I mentioned is monotonicity. Monotonicity means if you have a certain profile, and with a certain voting rule you get a decision at the end, a collective decision. Then suppose that one of these voters just moves up in his ranking, in his preferences, one of the candidate decisions, then this cannot be detrimental to the fact whether this candidate decision is going to win or not. So let's make a better example. So if A is the decision that is going to win in a certain profile with a certain voting rule, and somebody just improves the position of A in his ranking, then it cannot be that in this new profile A is not going to win, but somebody else is going to win. So monotonicity is something very reasonable to expect from a voting rule, but in some cases you'll see that there are some voting rules that don't have that property. And also, as I said before, when you start to collect a lot of desirable properties, you have to be careful, because if you put too many of these properties together, you may end up that the set of voting rules that satisfy those properties becomes empty. And in fact, you don't need to put together too many properties to have this set that becomes empty. And we'll see some examples. So the Mays theorem is the one that I told you informally before, that when you have just two candidates, the only thing that you can use is plurality. All the other voting rules collapse to that. And Mays theorem, in particular, more formally, has to do with monotonicity, has to do with anonymity and neutrality, that are definitely two properties that you want to have in a voting rule. They only mean that the result of the voting rule does not depend on the names of the candidates and does not depend on the names of the voters. Okay, so it's anonymous and neutral. Definitely you don't want to have something where, you know, the result depends on one or both of these things. It is monotonicity, and it has to do with monotonicity. And it has to do, with the plurality rule, which says that with two candidates, if you want anonymity, neutrality, and monotonicity, then plurality. That's the plurality rule, if and only if. Okay. There are some rules, as I said, that do not satisfy monotonicity. For example, a rule that does not satisfy monotonicity, I'll give it here, plurality, so-called plurality with runoff. Plurality with runoff is very simple. It says, first, you have two rounds. So first, you eliminate from the preferences of the agents all the candidates except the two with the most votes, okay? So, for example, here, you have 25 people voting A better than B better than C, 24 voting B better than C better than A, 46 voting this way. And then you say, okay, according to plurality, A gets 25 votes, B 24, C 46, so I eliminate B, because B gets less votes than A and C. So in the first round, B is eliminated, and now that B is eliminated, C goes to the top here, because B is not there anymore. So you have that C has 46 plus 24 votes, and A only 25, so C is the winner. So this is the way that plurality with runoff works. Okay. First you look at the top choices, and you eliminate all the ones that are except the top two. In this case, there are just three, so just one to eliminate. And then you do plurality with those candidate decisions eliminated, okay? Okay, of course, to do that, it is a bit going against the simplicity of plurality, because you need to be able to go into the ranking, not just the top choices, because once you eliminate the top choices, you also have to know the second choice to bring it up to the top in the second round. So plurality with runoff does not satisfy monotonicity. So let's look at one example. So you have this scenario, 27 vote like this, 42 vote like this, and then suppose that four of the voters in the first group, let's look at the winner. So here you have B is eliminated, okay, in the first round, and then C is the winner. And then suppose that C is the winner. So monotonicity says if somebody brings up C in the ranking, then C should still win. So it should not be bad for C. So suppose that four of the people here move C to the top. And then if they move C to the top, what do we have? We have that this becomes CAB, so they move to this second line, so instead of 42, you have 46 votes like that. Only 23 remain with this voting, and then 24 remain with this voting. So here, if you use again plurality with runoff, what happens? That A is eliminated, B, since A is eliminated, B goes to the top in the second round, and now B wins over C. So you see that some of the people took C, the winner in the initial scenario, took C and brought it up in the ranking, and C now is not the winner anymore. So this means that does not satisfy monotonicity. Okay? Okay, so there are many other desirable properties. For example, freeness is a property that says that every possible candidate, every candidate decision can come up as the result. So the function is onto, I mean, the codomain of the function is the whole set of possible candidate decisions. And this is something definitely you want to have. Unanimity, parito. Unanimity says that if everybody prefers A to B, then it cannot be that B is the result in winning decision, okay? Because everybody prefers some other candidate decision to B. The last one, non-dictatoriality, just says that something that definitely you want to have. It says that the result of the voting rule that cannot depend only on the preferences of one agent, independently of how the other people are going to vote. Okay, so there is no, should be no dictator in some sense. And the third one here says independence to irrelevant alternative. So this one says, suppose that, let's make it more, suppose that the result is not just one candidate decision, but the ranking of all the decisions, to make it simple, to explain this desired property. And then the relationship, whether A and B, two candidate decisions, are one above the other one or the opposite in the resulting ranking, should depend only on the preferences of the agents between A and B. It should not depend on what they think between A and C, or B and D, or any other candidate decision. So whether A is above B, or B is above A, by the collective decision mechanism, should only depend on what the people think between A and B, whether they prefer B or A, but not whether they prefer A to C, so irrelevant alternatives. And again, this seems like a very reasonable, you know, property to have. Non-dictatorship definitely is something that you want to have. This one and these two again is definitely something that you want to have. But unfortunately, once you put together these properties, you discover that, I mean, you discover, it was discovered, that it's impossible, so that no voting rule satisfies all these properties together. And this theorem by Harrow that got the Nobel Prize for this, and it shows that, apart from the properties that he considered, but it shows that that there are these, you know, collection of even simple and small collection of desired properties that if you insist in having, then I'm sorry, you're not going to have any way of aggregating the preferences satisfying those properties. Of course, there are ways to mitigate the result or to get around the result. For example, you can limit the domain. Of course, if you only have two candidates, you know that Harrow's theorem does not apply, and you have the best voting rule, which is plurality or majority. So you can limit the votes to certain shapes of the votes, and one of the shapes that have been considered is single pick, that I will tell you what it is. Or even just say, I don't care about some of the properties. And usually the property that people drop is the independence of relative alternatives, because you don't want to drop parito, you don't want to drop ontoness, freeness, you don't want to drop, dictatorship, right? You don't want to drop the non-dictatorship property, okay? So let's look at one example how you can limit the votes, so the single pickness. So single pickness means that when you look at the preferences of the agents over the candidate decisions, there is a linear order of the candidate decision such that for each agent, there is a candidate that the more candidate is far from this selected candidate, and the more the preferences go down. So in some sense, the preferences for each agent like go this way, that way, or this way. That's why it's called single pick. Because at most you can have one pick. So if you have a linear order of the candidates, say A, B, and C, okay, either you go up with your preferences, so you prefer A, the least, and then B, a little bit more, and then C, more, or you do the opposite, or there is a candidate, for example, B, such that the more you go far in the linear order from B, and the more your preferences go down. Okay? You cannot have preferences that go up and down like this in the linear order. Of course, it doesn't have to be A, B, C, but it's just important that there exists one linear order such that this property comes. So, for example, in the parliament, usually you have left to right, you know? And if you are a fan of a certain party, which is in a certain position of the parliament, usually you are single picked, because the more you go to the left or to the right of that party, the more your preferences go down, because they are farther away from your ideas from that party. So there are some real-life scenarios where it's reasonable to assume that your preferences are single-picked. And this, using the single-picked preferences, then the domains of profiles, the domain of your voting rule is so restricted that you get around the Arrow's impossibility theory, and you actually can have those properties altogether. Another property that people have considered is this Condorcet consistency. So Condorcet paradox is this one. It says that the collective preferences may be cyclic, meaning that you don't know what to choose out of the candidate decision, even if each single agent does not have cycles in his preferences. So consider three people voting like this. So they have a total order, no cycles in their preferences. But then, if you look at what the majority of people think, well, you know, two out of three people think that A is better than B, here and here. Okay? So the majority thinks that A is better than B. And then two out of three think that B is better than C, this one and this one. And then two out of three think that C is better than A, this one and this one. So the majority thinks, thinks that A is better than B, another majority thinks that B is better than C, another majority thinks that C is better than A. So collectively, there is a cycle here, which is called the Condorcet paradox. And then you may say, oh, okay, so then what do I do? What do I choose, since the majority has this, cycle in its preferences? And so people have decided, defined this notion of Condorcet winner. And the Condorcet winner is a candidate decision that beats every other candidate in pairwise elections. So if you look at two candidates at a time, there is a candidate decision A, for example, such that if you look at against B, there is a majority such that A beats B. And against C, also. Against D, also. So that's called the Condorcet winner. And when it exists, of course, it's unique, because since it wins against everybody else, there is nobody else that can win against everybody, because for sure it doesn't win against him. So it would be nice to have voting rules, to use voting rules that have that when there is a Condorcet winner, they actually choose that decision as the winning decision. So, and these voting rules are called Condorcet consistent. Okay. So that's another desirable property, and but even very simple voting rules are not Condorcet consistent. For example, plurality is not Condorcet consistent. Here you have this scenario where B is the Condorcet winner because B against C has 35 plus 31 votes, so the majority. B against A has 34 plus 31, so again the majority. So B would beat every other candidate, A and C, in pairwise comparisons. So B is the Condorcet winner, is the unique Condorcet winner. But the plurality here just look at the top choice, and it would say that A wins, because it has 35 votes instead of 34 and 31. Okay. Let's look at another very important property. When people get together to state their preferences and to agree that there is going to be a voting rule that takes these preferences and puts them together, does some reasoning, and generates the collective decision, people may do everything that it takes to get the best decision out of this collective process. And one thing that they can do is to manipulate in the sense of reporting insincere preferences, because they may understand that by doing that, they can get a better collective decision, better in the sense of their own preferences, individual preferences. Okay? So manipulation is defined in this way, but there are many other ways of influencing the results, but let's look at manipulation. So misreporting is on our own individual preferences in order to get a better collective decision. So let's look at one example of manipulation with plurality. So here on the top part, I have a profile where 49% of the people have this rank of the possible three decisions, 20% at this one, and so on. So by plurality just looks at the top choice. And so this one gets 49% of the votes, this one gets 40% of the votes, and this one 11. So this is going to be the winner, okay? So now, assume that these 11% of the people that are voting this way, assume that they know that we are using plurality, and in some way they know how the other people are going to vote. So by having this information, they can understand that if they misreport their preferences by not putting this as the top choice, but putting this one as the top choice, which is false because it's not the top choice, it's the second choice, then by doing that, the plurality will pick up this instead of the other one, and then this will be the winner. And for them, this is a better collective decision because otherwise, you see, they are getting the worst choice, okay? And in this case, they got the second choice. So these people have manipulated the result because they have, by misreporting their preferences, they have obtained a better collective decision according to their own preferences. And of course, being having a voting rule where manipulation is not possible would be very nice, but another impossibility results in social choice says that every voting rule is manipulable. Unless you want to give up non-dictatorship or freeness, the fact that every candidate should have the possibility to win. So this impossibility result is in some sense worse than the other one that I told you, because the other one you can get around in some ways that I described, but this one is really very bad. It says everybody rule, and of course you don't want to give up dictatorship, non-dictatorship, you don't want to give up autonomy. Everybody rule some scenario in which people can manipulate. And so what people have done here, they have taken a different route to mitigate the result, saying, okay, it may be that the voting rule is manipulable, every voting rule, okay? But some voting rules, for some voting rules, maybe it's not computationally easy for a single voter or a group of voters to understand what to do, how to misreport your preferences in order to get a better decision. So they turned it into a computational complexity issue to understand whether it's difficult to check if we can manipulate, okay? So computationally difficulty means that it may be computationally difficult for, again, a group of voters or a single voter to understand how to manipulate. For example, manipulation, there can be two kinds of manipulation. Constructive manipulation is that you want to formally, you're given a voting rule, you're given the votes of the other voters, and you're given a candidate, and you are asked, can I cast my preferences in a way that candidate wins? Okay? And this is a formal question which has its own computational complexity features. And for example, for the board rule, you have these three voters that vote in this way. And remember, board gives scores. So, for example, A gets a score of 4 because it gets 2 here, 1 here, and 1 here. So it gets a total 4 of score. B gets 3, C gets 2. So, given that you are voter number 4, and given that you know how the other people vote, and given that you know that you're using Borda, can you make a certain candidate, for example, B, win by putting your preferences into the system? And the answer here is yes, because if you vote this way, then the Borda scores will be this, and B would be the winner. So in Borda, we had to, how do you understand that you can actually do that? Well, you have to look at the border scores, you have to probably, what do? You look at all the possible ways of casting your vote, and you count the new scores, and then you see whether big can win or not. Okay? And you answer that question. Was it easy? Was it difficult for Borda? Well, you know, for many different body rules, people have studied the computational complexity of doing this, and there are many, many results. These are just a very incomplete table describing some of these results. So P, NP complete, for many different body rules and for many different number of candidates. But this is just to give you the idea that this is a whole line of research that people have started when they realized the computational complexity could be a way to mitigate this result. Another thing that came up when people started to use voting rules to aggregate preferences in real life scenario is that as I said before, usually your decisions are not tokens, A, B, and C, but are complex decisions, like we defined before with fuzzy constraints or CP nets. So they have different parts. And since they have different parts, usually they are each part has a set of possible candidate values, and then you combine all these parts together, so at the end you get an enormous number of possible decisions. So it would be impossible for you to just rank them, top choice, second choice, third choice, and so on. So for example, suppose we are talking about cars, you know, and you have your own preferences of a car, but you don't want to tell me, I prefer this car to this one, to this one, to this one, because the number of cars is too many. But you want to tell me, I prefer red cars to blue cars, I prefer, you know, this maker to the other one, and so on. So you have a large set of candidate decisions, usually, contrarily to voting theory, where, apart from the fact that voting theory does not care about computational issues, but in voting theory you have a completely different scenario. You have many, many voters in political election, for example, and few candidates with respect to the number of voters. Here you have instead usually few voters and a lot of candidate decisions. For example, all the solutions of a constraint problem, or all the web pages, but you don't have many search engines, you have few web pages. So, and usually this set of candidate decision has a combinatorial structure where you put together, as we said, parts and you combine them together. So the dinner example, like we said before, that you have to choose, decide what to cook for dinner, and you have four possible items, five options for each, so you have a lot of possible dinners. But of course, you don't want to ask your friends preferences over 625 explicit menus, you want to have some compact way of describing their preferences. And so that's why these compact formalisms like constraints, soft constraints, CP nets, and many others to model preferences compactly are very important also in this collective decision making scenario. So the example that I gave you just had, you know, the total order as the ranking, as the expression of the preferences of the agents, because I just had three or four token decisions. But in general, you may imagine that each one of the agents has its own CPNet to describe the preferences, or its own set of constraints. For example, for approval, it would be enough to have a set of constraints, because approval just wants the set of approved decisions, or a set of soft constraints, and so on. Of course, depending on the voting rule that you want to use, you may are forced to use one formalism or another one. For example, as I said, using constraints would be enough if you use approval, but using constraints would not be enough if you want to use Borda, because then you don't have the complete ranking, or not even partial. Okay? You just have two sets, the approved and the not approved. So let's consider what can be done when you have these complex decisions. So you have cars, menus, with several variables, each one with some values that are allowed for those variables. And then you say, oh, okay, so now what am I going to do? Because the result has to be a car, meaning one value for each one of the variables. A decision on the maker, a decision on the color, a decision on the engine, and so on. So what am I going to do to make these decisions? Am I going to just vote with some voting rules independently over these variables, and then put these this result of this voting, independent voting together, and this is going to be my card. This is one option. But actually, we, you know, it's easy to see that voting separately on each variable is not going to give good result in terms of satisfying whatever it means, the preferences of the agents. For example, suppose that here you have some voters that, and you're voting on three variables, and you just have two values for each variable, so yes or no, so it would be like three referendum in some sense. So suppose that out of these 13 voters, three of them vote for yes for the first variable, yes or no, yes for the first variable and no for the second one, and then the second one votes like this, and the third one votes like this. One voter votes for this, one for this, one for this, one for this, and nobody votes for not to the, all the three variables, okay? And now you put together by majority, but why by majority? Because for each, we are going to vote separately on each variable, and each variable is just two candidate possible decision, yes or no, so majority is the only thing that you can do. So in each variable you're going to vote by majority, and you will see by counting here that the winner is going to come out this one. So you see that something that nobody said that they preferred it is going to come out as the collective result if you vote independently on each one of the variables of your composite decision. So definitely it's not reasonable to vote independently, especially whether these things are not independent, but they are linked by constraints or dependencies like in CPNets. So the idea that people had is to actually, yes, vote separately on each variable, but in a sequence. Meaning that when you vote on each variable, you take into account the result of the vote on the previous variables in the order. Because this variable may depend on that, I mean the preferences of this variable may depend on the result on the voting on the other variables. So you're going to vote separately, but for each variable in a sequence. Well, here I just say something even more precise about the fact that if you vote independently over the variables, you may end up with what we call the Condorcet loser, something that really is the worst choice for everybody. We don't need to give this example in detail, but it's just the example that I gave before, which was the Condorcet loser, something that is not good for anybody. So let's look at what we mean by sequential voting. So sequential voting, again, is like voting for each variable independently, or not independently, one at a time, but in a sequence. Meaning that when you vote for the I variable in your ordering, you know the decision that you have already taken on the all I-1 previous variables in the ordering. And knowing that, the preference is that your agents are going to submit for the I variable may depend on the decision that have been taken before, and so the voting is over those preferences. So let's read one very simple example with soft constraints. So here you have again fuzzy constraints. You have two variables only, what pasta you're going to have and what drink, and you have three agents, and then you have pesto and tomato sauce for the pasta, and this agent, for example, says that pesto is the top choice, one, most preferred, and tomato is 0.7, so less preferred, and beer and wine, again, it gives something here, and then you have a constraint between these two variables, and for each combination of values of these two variables, you have what the agent thinks about whether they're preferred or not. Okay? In this particular example, every agent has the same constraint graph, but it doesn't have to necessarily be like that. One could have more constraints, less constraints, whatever. But the variables have to be the same, and the domains of the variables have to be the same, because those are defining the candidate decision, and the candidate decision has to be the same for everybody. So we're going to vote for each variable one at a time to decide the collective decision, which is going to be a value for pasta and a value for the drink. So first we're going to vote for that, and and of course there are only two options, so majority, so two out of three people prefer pesto to tomato sauce, so the result is pesto, okay? Now, given that we have made that decision, then we are going to propagate that decision into the rest of the constraint, the constraints graph of the various agents. And in particular, since we did not choose tomato sauce, we are going to give it a zero. So we are going to eliminate tomato sauce from the rest of the constraints, which would change the preferences of this over the other variable that we are going to vote the next round. And how are we going to propagate that? By classical constraint propagation. So we are going to say, tomato sauce is going to get a zero now, and now let's propagate with soft R consistency to the rest of the constraint graph. And so you are, see, tomato gets a zero, we're going to propagate this zero over the rest of the constraints, and so then new values come out here because of soft R consistency. And now that you did that, you have propagated this information onto the rest of the constraints, now you're ready to vote on the second variable, and the second variable, you have that unanimity, everybody prefers beer to wine, so the drink is the beer, okay? So you have voted each variable one at a time, but sequentially, and every time between one voting round and the next one, you propagate the information about the decision that you just made, okay? The same thing can be done with CPNets. So for example, here I have CPNet, you see three variables, two values each, different dependency graphs, because it doesn't have to be that they all have the same preferences of the same graph of dependencies. And here again, you use plurality because you have just two values for each. And here, location A, location B, here we're talking about two rovers, where to go. And two out of three prefer location A. And now, since here you see more clearly the how the things are propagated, because since we have chosen location A, we can delete, for example, the second line here, because we said that if location A, then analyze is better than image for this variable. So you just remove this second line here, right? Just location A. So you're just going to put what was the depending on location A and remove the other line. And now you're ready to vote on the second variable. And here you have two out of three that prefer to take an image, so the rovers are going to take an image. And then the last one, actually the last one you didn't have to wait because the last one is independent of the other variables. You could have done it in the first round. But anyway, we're doing it now. And here you see that two out of three prefer to go to station two rather than station one. So this one is the collective decision. Okay. And here, maybe in CPNet, because you have this explicit dependency means you see better how, you know, doing sequentially is important because you take into account what was decided before. But of course, you also see that doing it sequentially has to respect these dependency links in the CPNet. So for example, here I could not have chosen an ordering of the voting rounds which says first vote on what and then vote on where, because it would be incompatible with the dependency links of the CPNet. I could vote on this one anytime I wanted, but these two variables, I have to respect the voting, the dependency links. So the two ways that to model preferences, how do they influence this sequential voting procedure? Well, with some constraints, we saw that at every voting round, you have to, in some sense, do some constraint propagation, which in the case you don't have cycles is fine, but in the case where you have cycles, you have to solve the whole problem to propagate completely the information about the current decision onto the later variables. And so in some cases it can be tractable when you don't have cycles, but otherwise it could be computationally difficult, but there is no requirement. You can choose any order you want. Okay? While in CPNets, you have to choose an ordering of voting rounds that respects the dependencies, but then there is no solving projective because it's already explicit there in the CPNet. The last thing that I wanted to mention, and I'll just mention it without going into the detail, but I will give the slides so that people may want to look at it, is the area of stable matching problems. So I'm sure that people have looked at, have gone to David invited talk, And so they know everything of stable matching, but that's also very related to this. In that case, you still have preferences given by all the men and all the women over not candidate decision, but over the members of the other gender. Okay? And then given these two sets of preferences, you need to get to a collective decision, and in this case the collective decision is the matching. One man, one woman, man, one woman, and so on. Okay? And even in that case, you may wonder what happens when instead of having a list, explicit set of men and women, you have candidate people of one gender and the other one, which are described by some combinatorial structure. So, for example, you may have people that look for jobs and companies that are looking for people for jobs, but you don't want to list all the people. You want to list features of these people and combine them. Or from the other side, the companies that look for people to hire, you don't want to list all the companies if you are somebody looking for a job, but you want to list some features of these companies and then give your preferences over these features. So even in that case, the issue of constraints, soft constraints, and ways to model compactly your preferences over the other gender is very realistic and necessary, I think. And then you may want to understand how the usual algorithm to generate stable matching, like the Gale-Shapley or other algorithms, may be adapted into that scenario. So I just go to the end. Okay. So at the end, I just want to, you know, say again what I said at the beginning. I think that these two areas, social choice and CP, can contribute to each other in many significant ways. So CP in particular can contribute with modeling and reasoning frameworks for constraints and preferences, which are at the core of collective decision making. And then it can also provide tools for formalism to model and solve problems that people have in social choice, like the winner determination problem, you know, how to compute a voting role, or stable matching problems. On the other hand, the social choice can help CP if we think that one trend of constraint reasoning is in multi-agent constraint reasoning, where constraints and preferences come from different agents and you need to find a way to aggregate them together. So from that community we can get a lot of tools and properties and formalisms to understand how to do that, even though we need to adapt them as we described before, because we care about, for example, computational issues that people in social choice don't care. And I just want to say that I concluded here with some references for preferences of constraints, CP net, voting theory, manipulation, stable marriages, and that people may find useful to have all these references. Okay, thank you.